All right, everyone. Thank you for tuning in to the social topic. Social topic, if you're unaware, is something that I pick out kind of out of nowhere, and I don't necessarily give Tub very much time, if any at all, to prepare. Blind. Mm-hmm. Now, I did tell him a little bit about this right before we started recording, so he's not entirely blindsided. And sometimes it's a bit crazy, like that maps issue that we did. Boy, that one really got him.
Oh, my goodness.
And, man, that got me a lot of views on that, right? It was insane.
Isn't that frightening that that topic gets views? That should be a topic that gets buried and nobody even knows about.
I mean, you know, so, well, it was good to see that a lot of people were unhappy with that particular topic and in the thing.
Yeah, starting with the people sitting right here in this room.
Right.
Okay.
So, so I've seen this screenshot floating around on Twitter. And so let me go ahead and put it up on the screen here. So what we've got. Bam, it's from whitehouse.gov, and it says, now this is a snippet, so this isn't the whole speech.
Yeah, don't tell us that we're already at a bad start if it's whitehouse.gov.
Right, right.
That's whenever you send me to whitehouse.gov,
yeah, very bad start.
It's not good.
And so it says, we are intent on not letting Omicron disrupt work and school for the vaccinated. You've done the right thing, and we will get through this. And then it goes on and says, for the unvaccinated, you're looking at a winter of severe illness and death for yourselves. Your families, and the hospitals you may soon overwhelm. This emphasis is mine, of course. You know, trying to make it sound interesting. So like, I saw that and I was like, wow, like this. So I guess what gets me about this is that it's coming from the president, right?
Is it though? Like, well, you're doing, I'm like, what?
When you go to the White House, like, this is what the president said, right?
Yeah. Now, his speech writers, what's up?
Right.
You know.
But here's the thing. It's coming from him because he's the one being accountable for the words.
Yep. Uh-huh.
I get it. Somebody else probably wrote it.
Sure. Because
who knows? Maybe he even got handlers that are like,
I didn't know he was reading it.
Right. And yeah, maybe there's handlers that are like, this is what you're going to say. And he might say, no, I don't want to say that. And they'll go, okay, well, you know where Jeffrey Epstein is? That's where you could be. I don't know. I don't know how this all works.
I just refer to him as the reader in chief.
Right. There could be a deep state.
He just reads what's put in front of him and off they go.
And so, but whether it came from him originally, whether it comes from somebody else, really doesn't matter because he's the one saying,
the government's
you are the president of the United States.
Uh-huh. It's on your website, dude.
Is it appropriate? And I think no. Is it appropriate for the president to basically say, here's a reason for a great many Americans to be afraid this winter? I think that's inappropriate. Now, I don't think he should lie. If they think there is a credible threat, I don't think that he should lie and be like, it's all hunky-dory, everybody. You're cool. Enough people vaccinated. Don't worry about it. No sweat. Like, I don't think he should do that any more than I think he should get on there and be like, you are headed for likely a severe winter of death and just destruction. Like that just is a horrible thing for a president to say.
I'm going to attempt to stay away from the COVID side of this because we can all have the debate of how bad it is. It's not bad. We already know. I'm not going to get into that. But can you bring that back up for me for a second?
Yeah, we'll bring it right back up. We'll leave it up.
All right. So here's what I want to look at. Now, if we took the first part of that, and let me just, I'll play it as safe as I possibly can.
All right. We got to be safe because we're going to be putting this on YouTube and I don't want to get banned.
Okay. All right. So
might happen. I don't know.
So here's what's going to happen. So imagine if in the first part of that, it says, if we got rid of vaccinated and we put in white people.
Okay.
White people, you've done the right thing and we'll get through this. For the brown people, you're looking at a winter of severe illness and death for yourselves, your family. Because here's what I'm getting at. What he did right there was cause a separation of people.
Right.
You people are okay. You people are horrible. And you're causing everything to happen bad around you. And you know how you can tell it's bad? Plug in another situation.
Right.
Plug in white and brown people. And if you get a little upset and you go, okay, same thing.
Right.
It's still causing a separation of people.
Let me ask you, though,
because
some people might say, well, you have a choice to be vaccinated or not. You don't have a choice to be white or brown.
No, but what I'm getting at, though, is this. I'm focusing on the separation of.
Okay.
I'm not talking about, hey, this is this. I'm talking about, okay, you have a separation of people. I don't believe the president should be this intent on separating people.
Okay.
Okay? I believe there has to come to a point where we have to find a way to come together. Because I can assure you, you use language like this, and the unvaccinated people are just going to get angrier.
Right.
And now they're going to not do it out of spite.
Right.
Like, oh, that's how you're going to talk to me? Watch.
Right.
And because, so there's so many things that are wrong.
Right.
Science-wise inside of this. So
right.
I'm not even going to debate those things. We've gone down the COVID road before. Okay. So I look at this and I go, look what he's done. And so here's the problem, though. Other people, now people get past government and stuff like that. People will start thinking this way.
Right.
People, you'll see this filter down through the line. You're right. Those unvaccinated people, they're horrible. They're causing people to die. When in reality, we know that the vaccinated people are carrying the sickness and spreading the sickness and dying of the sickness also.
Right.
So
we just got canceled.
And done.
Yeah, that was our, you know, on Twitter, they're actually removing or they're cracking down on accounts that say the vaccinated can spread COVID too.
Oh, so now
you can actually get in trouble.
Anyway, I can say anything I want now.
I mean, you might as well, because I mean, we're just going to, I mean, I don't know.
Okay.
We're risking it.
My problem is this.
I'll go to Odyssey. I'm going there anyway.
But. It's done. All right. So now we can keep talking then.
Right.
Okay. Oh, now we got to talk like people are still going to watch this.
Well, yeah, see, keep watching. Don't tune out yet. Hey,
don't tune out until we're canceled. You can't see it.
Yeah. Don't help them cancel us.
So here's what I want to do. Part of the reason I wanted you to bring this back up. Look at, I don't know who Natalie Danielshin. Do you know who that is?
It's somebody that I follow that has a sizable following.
Okay. I have no idea who that is. Okay. But I like this statement.
All right.
Why does this feel like a threat? Not from COVID, no, but from the government.
Right.
Like, they're almost like, hey, we're going to get you. We're going to separate you. And this is what's going to happen.
Right.
And that's what makes me nervous.
Right.
Is that right there that they're saying, now that we see you as separate, you're those evil people, we can treat you a different way.
Right.
We can do different things to you because you don't think the way that we do.
Like, if there was a COVID management or a pandemic management bill, like in Australia, but here in the United States.
You mean like the one you just sent to me about New York?
Yes. And I don't have that one
up. What a segue that was. I know you don't have it. Oh my goodness, but how perfect.
I don't have it available. But apparently there's a bill. It's like are you able to pull it up? And we can read it to you. We won't be able to pull it up on the screen because I don't have it prepared at the moment. But what's the bill number?
In assembly? Is that the number?
I think it's 416.
416.
So, it was a screenshot that I found that I happened to run across. I did not verify it, so I don't know if it's an older one or the most current one.
Date is what? January 6th of 2021.
Right. So this is an old one. But apparently it's resurfaced, is my understanding, is that I don't know if it's this particular bill or if it's a new bill with the same language, but apparently this is resurfaced.
They're trying it again.
What they're basically trying to do is similar to the pandemic management bill that we talked about in one of our previous episodes. This one says the government has the authority to separate you from the population if they believe that you're a public health threat. Right, and
it's right. Yeah, as I say, if you want to read that, you can do whatever you want. Right there, the highlighted parts.
So here, it looks like it's in assembly pre-filed January 6, 2021. So even if it's not yet, even if it's no longer valid, the fact is it was.
And they try.
And they usually come back around with something similar, right? So an act to amend the public health law in relation to the removal of cases, contacts, and carriers of communicable diseases where. Who are potentially dangerous to the public health. And then you go down a little further.
As it goes down, yeah, it goes through.
And then it says, so upon determining by clear and convincing evidence that the health of others is or may be endangered by a case, contact, or carrier, or suspected case, contact, or carrier of a contagious disease, that in the opinion of the governor. So I'm going to stop right there.
Uh-huh.
Opinion of the governor, doesn't necessarily mean any kind of scientific.
Read the next part of that sentence. And the opinion of the governor and watch it.
After consultation with the commissioner, may pose an imminent and significant threat to the public health, resulting in severe morbidity or high mortality. The governor or his or her delegee, including but not limited to the commissioner or the heads of local health departments, may order the removal and or detention of such a person or of a group of such persons, so I don't know, maybe the unvaccinated?
Yep.
By issuing a single order identifying such persons either by name or by reasonably specific description of the individuals or group being detained.
Because people are going to say, well, the governor doesn't know me. But no. Look how far it goes down the line of people who can say that.
Right.
And so now, team this type of thinking up, because here it is. It's out there now.
Right.
Team that up with this post here.
Right.
And you start going, okay, wait a minute. They're making, I'm sorry. That post right there, the one you posted here, is a clear separation of people.
Right.
There's the good and the bad.
Right. And we've clearly classified them, so we know that this isn't ambiguous. It's you're either vaccinated or you're unvaccinated. Now, I want to interject on something. Mm-hmm. Whenever you see the term vaccinated or unvaccinated, or maybe fully vaccinated.
Fully vaccinated. That's right? A new one. Yep.
Fully vaccinated or vaccinated has effectively the same meaning. And that means you are up on all of the recommended shots.
Which means boosters and everything.
Boosters and everything. Mm-hmm. So if you're supposed to have three shots and you don't have the three shots, you're maybe, or in more than that, actually. It's, let's say that you went out and you got your, who is it that's doing the one dose? I don't remember.
Was it Johnson & Johnson? Maybe. Because Pfizer and Moderna, I think, were both two okay. doses.
So you got the J&J. One dose. So unvaccinated means anybody that is not 2 weeks past the last dose and is up on the current dose. Mm-hmm. So if you had a one shot and you got it 3 days ago, you are considered unvaccinated because it hasn't had time to do yep. its thing in your body. Mm-hmm. Same thing with the two shot or whatever. If you are not on the, if you have not received
it. I remember they were doing it. They were saying after you've had your second one, you are not considered fully vaccinated for like 2 weeks almost.
Correct. For 2 weeks.
So I was like, wait a minute. Okay.
And that's what a lot of people said because they were like, well, don't we want to know what the, you know, when we're looking at the data, shouldn't we break out people that are fully unvaccinated versus people that are either fully vaccinated or partially vaccinated?
And so there's the problem. They've caused a separation of you are this group or you are this group.
Right.
And now they've determined this group is bad and wrong.
Right.
And can I just add something? Yeah. It's up there and I keep looking at it. You understand, like, what sets me off about this? They're treating us like we're children.
Right.
Like, ooh, we're going to scare you with your scary story.
Right.
Like, you know, you understand. You're going to have a long, miserable, dying winter.
Right.
It's like we can't see, like, we're a bunch of six-year-olds that you go, hey, you know, if you don't go to the dentist, all your teeth are going to fall out of your head. And, and, you know, like, that's what they're doing because they're treating us like children.
Absolutely, yeah.
And I'm like, wait a minute. Why are we not seeing, like, how? Okay, so.
I didn't feel like that was assault and battery.
Let's go 18 months ago.
In my home.
It is in your home. Let's go 18 months ago. We'll go as far as 2 years ago.
Okay.
Let's say 2 years ago, if anybody had suggested, hey, you're going to have to show proof to go into a restaurant. Hey, you're going to have to do this in order to do things in your life. Hey, if you don't do this, they might try to separate you from society.
Right.
And every one of us would have laughed at that person.
Right.
How many times you'd have been like, oh, look at this idiot.
Right.
On Facebook, Twitter, whatever it is. This guy.
Right.
No matter, even libertarians would have been like, this guy.
Right.
But now look at it. You understand that now that's no longer this guy. Now it's a, oh, dang, that guy.
Yeah.
Well, that guy sitting back going,
there's told been some, you. There's been some tweets where people are like, what did the conspiracy theorists, you know, the people that you were considered conspiracy theorists, what did they say would happen next so I can be prepared?
Prepared. Because this is how fast this is actually moving.
Right.
Like, now, they're not, like, this, guys, like, it's just, oh, guys, all of us, they're not even hiding this.
Right.
And like, this is, and, here you
and,
go.
And how can we prove they're not hiding that? Look at
it's on whitehouse.gov.
whitehouse.gov, but then look at the tweet right below it from Representative Eric Swalwell. Swalwell. He says, this was tweeted like yesterday, on a flight now to the Bay Area, and it is 100% baddie that the unvaccinated are allowed to fly. It is unsafe in the cabin, and we are transporting the virus. Requiring the vaccine to fly is the least, in all caps, the least we can do to stop the spread.
Now, right? Bear in mind, Representative, he's a lawmaker.
Right.
So he is a lawmaker that right now has the majority. Their party has the majority.
Right.
And this is their thinking.
Yes. Yep. And this is the problem that we have. We got a government, we got a federal government that is using very clever language. It's not really all that clever, but in a way it is because people just kind of ignore it or ho-hum, no big deal. But it's clever language to divide us further, mm-hmm. not only telling us how they want us to be divided, but also scaring us in the process. So it's not even just saying, like, we're not really supposed to do this, but this is very much like the days of old. In the 1930s, when they said, you know, these Jews carry diseases. This is literally saying the unvaccinated carry a disease, right? Mm-hmm. Even though there's plenty of information from the CDC that suggests that, yes, vaccinated people can carry the virus as well. They can go to the hospital as well. They have breakthrough cases. This stuff happens. And so I think what we're doing is we're stoking more fear.
Yep.
We're dividing us. We're saying, hey, look, those people, these people, those people being the bad ones.
Like, why?
And then, hey.
Why is it Swalwell chiming on there going, hey, listen, you know what? We see this and this is not good. This is not helping us move together. This is not kind of getting us all on the same page. This is causing, right. Like, why are they not speaking of going, this is causing further division.
Right.
This is causing, we're trying to win people over. This is not the way that it's going to happen.
Right.
There's not going to be the people who go, oh my goodness, I'm in for a lot. You're looking at a winter of severe illness and death for yourselves.
Right.
Okay, let's clear something up. The people who have decided they're not getting a vaccine, that's not going to affect them. They're
right.
not settling on the reason to go,
right.
oh my goodness, a little severe winter.
This wasn't for them.
That's not what this is about. This is stoking the fire of the people who are on their side already. Because
right.
now they're saying, hey, all you good people, you know, with
right.
us, see what they're doing? That's going to get those people to go, you're right, those people are bad.
Yeah.
They are horrible. What yep. can we do about this? Well, I'll tell you, just watch. What can we do? How do we keep them from getting on our flights and
right.
going across the country with us?
Yeah.
What I always say, almost everything we do, I always go, what's next? What's the next thing when they start
yep.
saying those people shouldn't be around us? Okay,
I mean, this is what, our second winter now that mm-hmm. we're having with COVID?
Yep.
And we've had vaccines for about a year now.
Mm-hmm.
And at this point, and this is what I've told people, I'm like, everybody that wants a vaccine has probably gotten one. I have not heard a single news story. I've not heard a single person that has said, yeah, I mean, we had those early on. Like, hey,
yeah.
my grandma's trying to get her vaccine, but there's not enough, whatever, blah, blah. You know, like early on we had those cases.
Yep.
And so, yeah, that was an issue there.
But now
we're at a point where, like, if you want a vaccine, you could have it. Like
anywhere,
there's no problem. Like, we could walk out today and go get vaccinated if we wanted,
yes.
right? You know, and so it is not a problem. So you're right. This is not for the unvaccinated, because nobody who's unvaccinated at this point is going to look at that from the White House and go, ooh, you know,
it's time for a change. I think
maybe Biden
right.
is right. Maybe,
I don't want one of these long, miserable winters of severe
yeah.
illness.
You know, none of the vaccinated, but none of the unvaccinated are saying that, but the vaccinated,
mm-hmm.
they're looking at this and I mean, I've already seen it,
you know,
and the president has said it. This is a pandemic of the unvaccinated,
which is just a lie, but
there is a lot of rhetoric
mm-hmm.
against the unvaccinated and they're stoking the flames,
yep.
you know,
but
this,
the question is why? See, that's what we have to be afraid of. Listen, we're all about starting up a base.
Because how do you get the support when you're in power to do the things that you want to do? You get people behind you, and the first way to do it is to stoke fear. The easiest way.
Separate.
Right.
First thing you do is separate.
The easiest way to do all that is fear. And I'm going to make some connections here. That people may not like.
You about to drop
you know
some
what?
Stuff on us?
I'm right going
to
drop some stuff.
Do it
right now.
Here it goes.
Okay. So,
hope we haven't got canceled. That people don't get to hear what you're about to drop.
This
right
episode
here.
May not even. I better keep like double copies of this one, right? So, there's a lot of talk about white supremacy.
Okay.
And there are real white supremacists out there. There's
uh-huh.
like five. Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know. There's not many. Maybe 10. I don't know.
Okay.
They operate on the same principle. Look at all those black people. Look at all those. This, they're doing this, they're doing that. So there's a lot of haters. We just talked about in the previous episode, we talked about Dave Smith.
Mm-hmm.
And he went and debated this fellow named Nick Fuentes. And there's a lot of people that are like, oh, this Nick Fuentes, he's, you know, saying all these things about Jews and blacks and blah, blah. And one of the things that Nick Fuentes said, because I watched the debate.
Right.
One of the things that he said was, he basically said that this country, white people are going to be the minority. And he expressed that as a fear. And then he went further and he said, people of color, there's a lot of them that are in power or gaining power or will be in power, who will either be inhospitable, that will be inhospitable to whites or hostile to whites. So that's the reason why. So he's got this claim white people are going to be the minority. Mm-hmm. And then he's got this reason why that's a problem. The reason is because there's going to be hostility toward white people. And I disagree with him on right. both of those, okay?
Yep.
So very, very clear. You want to quote me that I said I disagree with him vehemently on both of those. But here's the deal. He's operating on the basis of fear when he talks to people. When he talks to white people and says, hey, we need to do something. We need to close the borders. We need to do this. We need to do that. He is operating on the basis of fear and saying, you need to be afraid that this thing can happen to you. So therefore, you will support these ideas that I have, these public ideas. So that is exactly what's happening here.
You're saying at this point right here, Nick Fuentes is whitehouse.gov.
I mean,
like what he's saying.
There is no difference in the procedure that is happening here. Mm-hmm. The White House has taken the same
language, basically.
The same language, the same rhetoric as Nick Fuentes, and they're saying, you need to be afraid of this group of people. Nick Fuentes is saying the same thing. White people, you need to be afraid of this group of people. Now, I'm gonna go a little further.
Okay.
Can I preach?
Listen.
Can I preach?
It's still your house. Can
I get on this? I'm gonna say some stuff.
Okay.
This is directed more toward the libertarians. Okay. So if you're not libertarian, you're not watching
you can stop listening.
Just may be a little bit more unfamiliar with this.
Okay.
And I'm not going to go into all the details to help you. If you don't know, you don't know. You'll just have to figure it out some other way because we're pressed on time and I don't have time to give the backstory.
Yeah, but all your explanation about not having the backstory is taking the time that you could have given the backstory. Oh, but anyway, go ahead.
So we have a Mises crowd, a Mises caucus in the Libertarian Party. And there's a lot of people that don't like the Mises caucus. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that they didn't like about them is that they were using this language of takeover. Oh, they're going to take over the Libertarian Party, right? I wasn't really a big fan of it, but for different reasons. And a lot of people say, hey, look at all this rhetoric that they're using. We need to be afraid of what they're going to do when they take over the party, right? It's the same thing. So if you are a libertarian, and there are some libertarians who are comfortable with what's being said on the White House, but they're not comfortable with, yeah, there are some. And there are, and these are the some of these same ones.
Hold on. All right. So you're telling me there are libertarians that would take this statement that's right there and be like, yeah, okay.
They would. There are some who believe that I think there might even be some that are okay with mandates. We're not going to get into that. That's a different topic.
That's a conversation we'll have as soon as you click end on this
Right, one. Right. But here's the thing. If you're a libertarian and you don't see anything wrong with what you see from whitehouse.gov right here, but you are also the same libertarian that says, this Nick Fuentes guy, he's terrible and he should be shut down.
Uh-huh, but
and you are the same person that said, this Mises crowd, I don't like the language that they're using because they're coming from a place of fear. Then you are a hypocrite because this language is the same. It's the exact same thing. Right? They're operating on the basis of fear and they are working to get the unvaccinated people separated from people who are vaccinated.
And I think we have to understand something.
From the vaccinated side. They're stoking fear of the vaccinated people.
But think about what you've already said in this one, in this section here. You said about how it's the boosters and stuff along those lines. Because there are going to be people, I'm telling you, there are going to be people who read this and go, I got my two shots. Yeah, I don't fit into that category. I'm okay.
Right.
But then you're going to find out, you know what? Even the people who got your two shots, you're still now the unvaccinated.
Right.
Because you didn't get the boosters accordingly.
When they call for a booster. And even if you go and get the booster, it becomes a situation of, you know, they came for the communist and I wasn't a communist, so I didn't say anything.
Right.
So eventually what ends up happening is, if you're lucky, you always remain in the crowd of people that are, what does it say? Done the right thing.
The majority of it. Well, look at us. Uh-huh. What happens when you're
But 2 years ago, 2 years ago, nobody would have said, you are doing the right thing, by your country. They wouldn't have framed it as a patriotic duty.
Right.
2 years ago to say that you need to get vaccinated. We would have laughed at this idea. Mm-hmm. Right. Now we're not laughing. There are people who are looking at it and saying, I did the right thing.
I've never heard this over the flu shot.
No.
I think
if you go back to like 1918 when they had the flu pandemic, I think there was kind of language like this.
Okay.
And a lot of people.
Okay, but now. Right. Okay. We had a flu shot available for as long as I can remember.
And I'd have to go back and look at historically and say, okay, were they as aggressive as they are now? I like to think that they were not based on anything I've seen. Because, you know, what we're not seeing is we're not seeing people that are saying, hey, everything that's happened, every measure that the government's taken was all taken in 1918 and it all went away. Nobody's ever saying that.
No.
So I'm left to believe that since people aren't defending it based on past history, it has not happened to this degree. And we're going to find out that it is not going to end up in the same way that the flu did. I think we're going to find out that this is going to keep going.
Right.
I mean, we've had calls for like almost the entire year to restrict people who won't get vaccinated. We've had those calls.
Mm-hmm.
We had Cato Institute. Yep. They recently published a number of things that suggested that mandates are okay. They did it on the basis of, as long as there's an alternative, it's okay. And I'm like, that is a huge slippery slope, and you ought to know better.
Because what happens when the alternative changes?
Right.
What happens when this goes to this? And then
I mean,
this goes
effectively,
to this?
Let's be honest. When you say it's okay for the government to put a mandate on people because there's an alternative and that alternative is they can just go and get tested, you know what? That, in my mind, that's really no different than saying, hey, you know what? It's okay to slap your wife because she could just get divorced. She could just leave you, you know, and so it's okay.
Or you're
he's got an alternative, so like, it's okay to slap her.
It's the idea that you can't stab your wife, but you got to get a point across, so smack her.
Right.
Because it's okay, so I'm not choosing this horrible thing, but I'm doing the next not so bad thing, and all of a sudden it's okay. Because that's the same thing. Right. That's the same premise.
We're justifying a terrible thing because a not so terrible thing exists.
It exists, yeah. So now it's you don't have to get the vaccine, but you can go get tested. But have you noticed they've started making the testing for places more and more difficult? They started saying, this is how often you're going to get tested. You're going to have to pay for it yourself.
Right.
They've really started coming across where you finally go, I don't want to deal with this, you know? So not to travel down, which we probably already have a little bit, to travel down the vaccine road. Like I said, for me, this wasn't about a vaccine. This is about the separation that they're causing. And then the question becomes, why?
Right.
Why are they so desperately looking to cause a separation of people? What's next?
Right. And I think that's the question that people need to ask. And it doesn't matter if you're vaccinated. It doesn't matter if you support people getting vaccinated. We both support people getting vaccinated if they want. And I generally believe that vaccines are a good thing, right?
Yeah.
Like nothing is ever 100%. Nothing works all the time. You know, there are some issues. And you know, we're not going to try to delve into the conversation of like, how good or not good are COVID.
This isn't a vaccine conversation.
Like this is not a vaccine conversation.
No.
This is why is the government so intent on separating us and using language like this, saying you've done the right thing? They've basically made it a moral matter, right? And they're basically saying like, this is a moral issue.
That's what good people do.
And you know what? We were supposed to be a country, or at least I know a lot of people that support this kind of language, and they would be the first ones to oppose and say, hey, we can't legislate morality.
I'm a big advocate of that.
And that's exactly what we're trying to do here. We're labeling something moral, and then we're trying to legislate for it, right?
But
so we need to ask, what's coming next? And I don't think it's good.
No, that's what I'm saying. Look at how it says, we will get through this.
Right.
Us good vaccinated people who follow the government and trust the government for everything. Oh, we'll get. And here's the thing. It's almost like they're saying, if you follow us, we'll take care of you. You let the government run your life and you'll be okay. Don't be like those other ones.
Right.
Don't be like those other horrible people.
And
that's the problem. It's not like they're saying, hey, here's two good ideas. Pick which one you want. They're saying, here's our idea. And you need to get on board with this one.
Right.
Like you need to be in. And for the government to do that, that's frightening.
Right.
Because
everybody should be afraid of this.
Because every government holds the gun.
Right.
I always say government get whatever they want because they hold the gun. Right. They hold the ability to make laws and then enforce laws however they see fit.
And if you think, hey, I'm vaccinated, this is cool, it's okay, just remember, it wasn't you that decided who was doing the right thing and who wasn't. It was the government.
Mm-hmm.
That's who. So one day, your turn may come.
Yep.
And the government may decide that what you're doing, whatever it is, is not the right thing.
They found out it worked. Hey, last time we did this.
Yep.
They all fell in line.
Yep.
Let's try this next thing.
So that's what we got. We're right at about 30 minutes here. I don't think there's much more to say. Who knows how long this will even stay up on YouTube.
Fight the man.
Fight back.
Fight the man.
Call up your Congress members. Yell at them. Say absolutely not. If you're in California, call up. I mean, I know there's not going to be very many of you that will be willing to do this because you voted this man in. But, you know, contact Swalwell's, his office, and be like, hey, absolutely not. No.
Hold on. On your line of alternative, like, hey, dude, if you feel like that, why don't you drive instead?
Right. I mean, you
Eric,
notice.
What difference does it make?
Right.
Just drive.
Yeah,
just drive
Eric,
your way. You'll be fine. You don't
loser.
Have to worry about being around those great unvaccinated people.
Right. Like, you had a choice, right?
Yep.
Like, it was, I mean, it says on a flight to the Bay Area. I don't know where he was coming from, but probably anywhere in California.
Guess
you can
what?
Drive.
You can drive. Guess what? Hey, here we are in Florida. You know how you can get to California if you don't want to fly?
Right.
You drive.
Yeah, if it's so unsafe in the cabin, why are you still there?
Yep. You can get out. You have an option.
Answer me.
Yeah. Eric Swalwell, we expect to hear from you on this one.
I better see you in the comments. All right. I think that's enough.
That's
we're done.
Enough.
All right. Thanks for listening, everybody. We are, check out some of the other episodes. I've got a lot of things coming out. We're doing the 25 issues, Libertarians on 25 issues, where we walk through 25 major issues. And we just kind of give you an idea of what libertarians generally think. It's not the all end all be all. Definitive.
Yeah, we don't solve everything.
Yeah,
but
it's not the definitive answer to all the topics, but it gives you a good idea of what libertarians believe. And then I'm also doing this new series that's just getting going now. It's called Liberty Dad Dad Talk. I'm bringing on dads, just regular everyday dads, right? And I'm just having a conversation about what's important to them. So check that out. But in the meantime, make sure you stand on the necks of the legislators and whoever. So, because this thing is getting serious. With that, we're heading out. That's all for this episode. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit that subscribe button and connect with me at Liberty Dad on Facebook, Liberty Dad Pod on Twitter, or send me an email to libertydadpodcast@gmail.com. I'd love to hear from you. To catch Liberty Dad episodes when they air, head over to facebook.com/freespeechmedia, where the weekly episode airs Monday night at 8 p.m. And while you're there, be sure to check out the other free speech media shows. Prefer an audio format? Then head on over to libertydad.com or just search for Liberty Dad, all one word, on your favorite podcast app. Remember, if you're a champion of liberty, your business is people, and your product is liberty. Have a great week. Catch you next time, and I'm out.